हाँ
आई वेंट टू अमरावती एंड ही कुलकर्णी ही रियली ही लेड आउट फाइव केसेस। आप देखो ये नेलिंग किया है इतना अच्छा है, नेलिंग किया है इतना अच्छा है, तब से आई चेंज ओवर टू नेलिंग।
नहीं नहीं मैं आई कन्फेस पब्लिकली एंड आई एम गोइंग टू कन्फेस आल्सो इन पब कि पहले मैं प्लेटिंग ही करता था।
आई वेंट टू अमरावती एंड ही कुलकर्णी ही
We are live.
क्या हो गया तुम बदली करने वाला था नीरज हमारा कुछ
हो गया सर। हाँ वर्चुअल बैकग्राउंड सर अभी लेकिन लाइव हो गया।
अभी लाइव हो गया ओके।
जस्ट गो बिसाइड्स द वीडियो, बिसाइड्स द वीडियो, वीडियो नीचे लिखा ना स्टॉप वीडियो राइट साइड पे, लेफ्ट साइड पे बॉटम, लेफ्ट बॉटम स्टॉप वीडियो, उसके बाजू में एक एरो है,
उसके बाजू में एक एरो है
हाँ उस पर टैप कीजिए।
सिलेक्ट माइक्रोफोन सिलेक्ट सिस्टम
बिल्कुल नहीं, नहीं वो नहीं उसके राइट साइड पे जो एरो है, ये पिक्चर लेफ्ट नहीं राइट साइड स्टॉप वीडियो के राइट साइड।
उधर तो कुछ है ही नहीं हमारे, उधर स्टॉप वीडियो के राइट में। हाँ 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 या अभी आया,
बाकी लोग ज्वाइन हो गए, तू कैसे नहीं ज्वाइन हो पा रहा?
चूज वर्चुअल बैकग्राउंड।
यस सर।
तो क्या क्या वर्चुअल बैकग्राउंड अभी कैसा
मार? नायगरा फॉल डाल दो सर, नायगरा फॉल
इधर लिखा, इधर है कुछ?
नायगरा फॉल डाल दीजिए
भाई। इधर है किधर, क्या ऐसा कैसे मालूम पड़ेगा किधर है?
गूगल से निकाल के वहां कॉपी कर दो सर, पेस्ट कर दो।
ओके आई थिंक चांडक सर इज आल्सो जॉइनिंग, so we can start.
नितिन
यस सर, बोला सर।
अरे कहा गया अपना वो ये शेषनाग कहा गया?
वो नीरज बात कर रहा है उससे, अभी देखते हैं क्या होता
है। यस जॉइन
स्टार्ट नाउ। अशोक विल यू स्टार्ट?
या गुड इवनिंग एवरीबॉडी एंड वेलकम टू दिस ट्रॉमा मास्टर क्लास बाय ट्रिनिटी एज वी कॉल इट, डॉक्टर गाडेगोने, डॉक्टर तन्नाड एंड डॉक्टर चांडल। And we welcome all of you for this first edition of this orthopedic trips, tricks and techniques video. So we have with us Dr. Tanna and Dr. Gadegone. Dr. Chandak is just joining in a minute. So today's topic is on forearm fractures. And we have our first speaker, Dr. Gadegone, who will talk about IM nailing in forearm fractures in adults. So over to you, sir, and welcome.
Okay. Good evening, sir. Good evening, Tanna, sir.
Good evening.
So this is in all webinars in last 1 month, this was the only neglected part of this body. And we thought that we should attend this forearm fractures, how to deal with this. Though they look very simple, they are more common. And there are some problems in management and results are varying with varying surgeons. Now this is I am nailing in forearm fractures in adults. I don't want to discuss anything about the plating. If you ask me, do you like plating? Yes, I like plating, but I am ardent follower of the nailing and I am converted from plating to nailing after seeing the result of our Dr. Chandrasekhar Kulkarni from Amravati. Historical background, a literature grossly inadequate. Even Google failed to show convincing references regarding nailing in forearm fractures in adults. Dealing with forearm fracture, I am in the midst of Bhishma Pitamaha, Professor and Guru Dr. Tanna sir, Master of Internal Fixation of Aram Chandar, and I am still a learner Abhimanyu, how to come out with this Chakravyuh from the management of the forearm fractures. Fracture of the forearm is stabilized by one of the three systems of fracture fixation in adults. One is a compression system that is most popular, and majority of the surgeons all over the world they are doing. Another technique is a splinting technique, that means intramedullary nail, rimmed or unrimmed nail. And second is a hybrid system where one bone is treated by plate and other bone is treated by the nail. Or even in the plate also we can do a compression plating in one bone and bridge plating in other bone. That is known as a hybrid system. Intramedullary fixation belongs to internal splinting system. And this is how to define this splinting, a construct in which micro motion can occur between bone and implant, providing only relative stability without interfragmentary compression as you do it in splinting system. In this technique, bending movements are neutralized, but telescoping and rotational torsional movements are not prevented. However, telescoping movement is conducive for fracture union. Fracture heals by secondary intention, and there is a huge callus formation because of the relative stability after intramedullary nailing. Why this then it is not a very popular method as compared to the plating? It's because radiation ulna have an important role in positioning of the hand. The ulna has a stabilizing role. The radius is articulated in a way which allows it to roll over the ulna with the attachment of the interosseous membrane. And moving the hand from supination, that is external rotation, to pronation means internal rotation. And it is described in literature that the fractures of the both bone forearm should be treated like an intra-articular fracture and not the simple fracture, which needs accurate anatomical restoration and rigid internal fixation. That is the philosophy of AO also. What is more important in this radius and ulna fracture is the restoration of the radial was important in the reconstitution of the normal architecture of the forearm and in the restoration of the rotation and grip strength. That means restoration of radial bow has a bearing on choosing the fixation method, whether to use plate or nail. Intramedullary nailing was tried since long in the 40s and early 50s. Diaphyseal forearm fracture nailing with K-wires, small raspings yield poor result due to lack of fixation. The first oversized straight square shaped rim nail was done and developed by Street in 1954. And restoration of the radial bow was introduced by Sage with the development of pre-built nail system. And their papers are already published in literature, but there are no many takers of these methods. This is pre-built triangular nail. Way back in 1959, this article was published near about in 50 patients by open reduction and internal fixation by pre-bent triangular nail gives good results. Pioneer in India, Dr. A.K. Talwalkar, Mumbai, designed and propagated a square nail. It was abundantly used all over the India. Square nail provides rigid fixation, it's doubtful. prevent rotational forces to act at a fracture site? That is also doubtful. This nail being a malleable and pre-bent preserves null work normal curve of the radius. That has been depicted in their article, which is published way back in 1967 in Singapore Medical Journal. That is also not a PubMed index journal. So these are the results. Fracture both bone forearm treated by a square nail achieved 100% results. Khare et al. Showed union rate of 95.6 in a series of 46 cases with good restoration of the radial bow and supination and pronation. This was done by anterograde ulna nailing and retrograde radius nailing, closed or open method. Moda et al. Have observed 90% union rate with square nails. The average period of POP mobilization for near about 6 weeks above elbow cast. Complications were many: non-union, malunion, infection, nerve palsy, joint stiffness, particularly in rotation, jamming of the nail while doing surgery. It's because it was mostly unribbed nailing, and splitting of the shaft because of the hammering of the nail in the medullary cavity. But most dreaded complication after doing so many other things is the implant migration and painful prominent hardware and ulnar bursa formation, mostly in the elbow region and sometime in radius before the fracture union has occurred, which has resulted into the painful infected bursa after doing a both bone forearm nailing. That was the most dreaded complication which we observed in our practice. So if the Kunstner filling, principle of filling the canal is to be followed, a straight rigid nail could not meet all the necessary requirements of restoration of the radial bone. So when you are doing a nailing in both bone forearm fracture, it should be a flexible nail. It should be a malleable nail. Then it is possible to restore the radial bone and negotiate the nail into the canal of the bone. Another principle, a rust principle, a thin nail, if you pass, what will happen? Thin nail permits rotatory and substantial lateral motion at the fracture site, which may predispose to delayed union, non-union, and subsequent instability at the fracture site. Therefore, nailing per se is not popular amongst the orthopedic surgeons all over the world. But with the introduction of new things, locked IM nail, recent development, there are many names are given: true flex nail, foresight nail. They are not available in India, but in India, now the interlock nails are available. There is a distinct advantage of locked intramedullary nailing technique is the capacity of preventing shortening in metaphyseal, comminuted, and segmental diaphyseal forearm fractures. And there is a compare. There are various many literature is coming up, comparison between locked intramedullary nailing and plate osteosynthesis in the management of adult forearm fracture. Two fixation methods yield similar result in terms of functional healing and patient satisfaction in the management of adult forearm fracture if you carefully do the surgery and lock the nail properly near the elbow, preventing the injury to the posterior interosseous nerve and to the superficial radial nerve at the wrist joint. Interlocking nailing in forearm fracture, technically demanding procedure. And you can see here the locking is in the proximal metaphyseal portion, locking is in the distal portion, just to prevent the migration and also fixing one end at the metaphysis of the radius and other at the ulna. Same principle I have used, a new concept in the management of both bone forearm fracture with intramedullary implant. This screw type of design fits into the radius metaphysis and the ulnar metaphysis, avoiding the interlock system. So it is available in tooth 2.5, 3 mm, variable length, titanium or steel you can use, a threaded end at the end of the nail, self-cutting thread to be screwed with screwdriver, screw head is placed at the end of the bone to prevent migration. And this is the close-up view of the screw nail. These are the screws. They are fit into the metaphysis of the radius and ulna, and you can use a screwdriver to drive you inside the medullary cavity. This is an elastic nail. Nail to be made up of metal sufficiently elastic to bend as it traverses canal from the point of insertion, but resilient enough to spring back to pre-bend contour when finally seated. That is the principle of elastic nail. And it should be rigid enough to withstand torsional, rotational, and angulatory forces. And therefore, the nail should be 2.5 or 3 mm. If you use less than 2 mm nail, probably you may require a longer period of immobilization in above elbow cast. Bowing up the radius can be achieved by the proper contouring of the nail. This is to maintain the normal rotation of the radius and ulna, and therefore you require a bending of the radius nail. Ulna nail is not required. Preoperative preparation, full length x-ray to study comminution, segmental fracture, diameter of the canal, radioulnar joint injuries, and length determination, that is the most important. And if you in doubt, you have to compare with the normal bone. Procedure, radius nail mounted on a chuck. You can have this self-grapper, and it should be a contoured nail for radius, contouring of radius nail. The insertion should firmly grasp the nail to order to control rotation, insertion, and nail withdrawal. Manual traction, or you can use a CA distractor, which is available in the market in the name of CN Kulkarni and Ajit Phadke. This you can use it. It is freely available in market, and it avoids a second assistant. This is, you can do an internal or external rotation. That is also can be done. And the CR manuality is very easy. Nail insertion and reduction procedure, radius nail entry window is the styloid process, or you can use a Lister tubercle, anything you can use. I use a styloid process because it gives me a anatomical landmark which is easy for insertion of a bone. Radius nail entry window through the radial styloid between the tendon of external carpi radial is longus and extensor pollicis brevis. You can see this is the radial entry point. There is the radial nerve is there. So you have to give a very small incision, dissect with the RT forceps, go to the bone, and then put your bone hole and dilate your cavity. That should be done. Now, which nail should be done first? The reduction of that particular nail. Suppose if the radius nail has come reduction, you pass a radius nail. If ulnar reduction is there, then ulnar nailing is done. Majority of the time, ulna is reduced first, and then you do a radius nail. Ulnar nail entry, nail near the site and manipulate reaction under Plautus control. There are two points of insertion. One is at the tip of the olecranon and other at the side of the olecranon near the anconeus attachment. That also can be done so that it goes from the lateral side, preventing the migration of the nail at the tip of the ulna, but which is not necessarily found in this screw intramedullary nail. Now in the reduction, how to get it? By manual traction, or sometime you can pass a percutaneous K wire like this and then bring in alignment the both the fracture fragment together. I preferably do a ulna nailing, that is a rimmed nailing and radius unrimmed nailing. So rim the canal till the fracture site, align the fracture fragment with the K wire percutaneously, and then negotiate the reamer into the distal fragment and then pass the nail. So this is how it is. Ulnar nailing is done. This is the radial nailing is there. You can pass with a small incision, and this is the placement of the radius nail, and this is the ulna. In disparity of the canal, because the fractures of the proximal part of the radius, ulna is okay. You can do a stack nailing also if there is a canal is wider. More or less, it is a stress, there is a very little bend. But in the radius fracture, there is a disparity of the canal, and that is the only part which precludes majority of the surgeons from doing the nailing. Now you can see here in this fracture, this is the entry point. Nail is passed and there is a translation of the proximal fragment. And how to deal with this? Because the anatomy is not restored, though the radial ulnar joint is in good position, but it is going to go, because with the compression of the fracture, settling of the fracture, this will dislocate. Therefore, you pass a small thin nail by the side of this first nail and pack the canal. And what will happen? You will wonderfully will find that the translation will definitely will be corrected. And this is the video. You can see here how the translation, this is it. And you can see here, after passing a very small thin nail, you have filled the canal and the fracture side, and you will find that the translation has been corrected. So it's very easy to do it by the side of the nail. You pass a thin nail, you can pass a K wire, rust nail or anything, and you can see if you fill the canal diameter at the fracture side by additional nail, it will correct your. So translation of the fragment in a wide medullary canal can be corrected by filling the canal with the additional nail. This is the additional nail. Perfect anatomical restoration. And this nail additional will go in the diaphysis near the isthmus area. It will fit, and then we have to cut it. Example, this is the radius Galagia fracture. Galagia fracture, plating is the gold standard. Plating is the gold standard. But to tell you very frankly, in last 10 years, I have not done a plating in a lower end radius fractures or Galagia fracture. I do close nailing, and that too mostly a stack nailing. But I am not against of the plating. Plating is the gold standard for Montegia and Galagia fracture. This is the example. Advance the nail beyond the fracture site into the radial neck, and the tip of the nail should be situated distal to the radial head without penetrating the joint. And there should be near about 5 mm gap between the articular surface and the nail, because if there is a compressive portion settling of the fracture, there should not be an intra-articular migration of the nail. Last thread of the spiral should be located outside the bone to make the removal of implant easier. Post-operative, above elbow cast, and maybe for 6 weeks, 4 weeks or 6 weeks, depending on the stability of the fracture after removal of the stitches. And you can see, I can quote innumerable examples. This is the fracture, most unstable fracture. It is called fracture at the same site of ulna and radius. Did close fracture at the distal different side. One is in the mid, other in the upper one third. Another example, fracture at the same side. Both bone forearm nailing, perfect anatomical restoration. Different side. Nailing, you can see the restoration of the radial curve has occurred. It's a comminuted butterfly fragment and perfect restoration and full function. This is a comminuted fracture. You just do a nailing and achieve the length and see inferior radial and if it is not there, or if there is some dislocation, you can pass a 3 weeks K wire from ulna to radius in comminuted fracture. If the fracture is left closed, the bone grafting has been unnecessary, and that is in the Campbell's operative orthopedics. And even in the recent literature also, it is written. Closed intramedullary nailing in a single bone gives excellent results. Single bone fracture, plating is the gold standard. But you see my result, you will find if you do it properly, stack it properly, and give a above elbow arm cast for at least 4 weeks. Another example, comminuted radius fracture, restoration of the length and perfect anatomical restoration and function. Another example, close intramedullary isolated fracture of radius and ulna. Innumerable example I can quote, very few they go for hypertrophic non-union, but majority they union. This is how it is a infected non-union, everything was excised, Nicholas procedure was done, nailing through that fibular graft, bone grafting, and ultimately everything healed, and there is no subsidence of fracture as well as restoration of the radial bone. Another telescoping movement is conducive for fracture union. Now this is the fracture of the both bone forearm. Stack nailing was done here. You can see here, there was some distraction at the both the fracture side. But with the exercises and pull of the muscles, telescoping movement occur and everything heals around the nail. This is the example. So nailing pitfalls and pearls. When nailing a distal shaft of the fracture, the tip of the nail will cross the fracture site and press on the opposite cortex. Because it goes from the styloid process or from Lister tuberculosis towards the distal part, which hits here, and there is a translation. This will not happen in a more proximal fracture. Distal fracture, this is more common. And therefore, stacking is the answer. Pass a small additional screw. Additional nail will prevent translation and as well as it will fill the canal, give the rigidity to the structure. And if there is an issue of inferior radial nerve joint, pass a K wire in supination from ulna to radius for at least 3 weeks. Plaster cast is must for about 4 weeks to 6 weeks. Nailing of the forearm will achieve the relative type of stability, though fixation of both bone or with bone intact may not adequately control the rotations, especially in segmental fracture. Plaster cast is required. Rehabilitation takes longer and permanent or significant loss of motion as it is described by many new workers and those who are the proponent of plating. These are the against point. I will see. Chandler's law of closed treatment after fracture of long bone. The associated joint will tolerate fixation for the duration of the normal union without either permanent or significant loss of motion. First myth, plaster causes permanent stiffness of the joint. It is because we have not violated the joint. when the joint is not violated, why you should become a stiff after a 6 weeks of immobilization? Another, the incomplete reduction of one bone might produce a distraction of the other side. This is the article. It is way back in 1957. Now we are in 2020. It's because that time the radial bow was very difficult to restore because of the nail system. But now with the elastic nail, it is possible to reduce the fracture properly and also restore the bow. And if at all it occurs in clinic practice, it is rarely observed. But with careful thumping and compression, distraction can be reduced, and therefore this is not valid. In loss of radial bow leads to restriction of rotation of the forearm. This is also mostly a theoretical. Restriction occurs in a terminal range, which is not required in majority of the patients. Actually, if you do a pronation and supination, unless there is injury to the tricartilage, no functional impairment occurs. So this is the fracture example. Segmental fracture, close reduction and nailing was done, and you can see there is some problem and issues with the reduction. And you can see a full function 5 years follow-up. This is, he is in military. Wagha border does everything, Shetty. And he sends me greeting in every Diwali. So full function, nothing occurs. So there is just some problems in the DRU joint, but in majority of the patient, they don't complain. When both bone forearm fracture, if radial bow is lost, the ulna probably adapts the shape to allow the full rotation. In isolated radial shaft fracture, it is probably more important to retain radial bow in Galagia fracture. So Galagia fracture, I cannot say. Galagia fracture, gold standard is the plating, though I do nailing. Principle is a 3-point fixation of the elastic nail. Unlocked intramedial nailing technique result in a less damage to the soft tissue and vascular supply compared to the open reduction and internal fixation by plate. How it works? Elastic stable intramedial nailing fracture is a primarily in the adult forearm fracture. This method works by 3-point fixation of stack nailing. The elasticity of the construct allows for ideal circumstances for micromotion for the fracture healing and healing by secondary intention. The amount of stability obtained after the operation is unbelievable. Do it. The patient with sedentary occupation can go to work. Another important advantage of intramedial implant, stress sharing behavior, which leads to secondary periosteal callus formation. Demerits, nothing always works. Highly comminuted fracture, fracture at the end of the bones, backing out of the nail and bursa formation. Therefore, we have to choose a diaphyseal fracture is a major indication of both bone forearm nailing. Advantages, shorter operative time, less radiosocial scar, implant removal easy, no chances of refracture, and you can do a stitchless surgery if you plan to do it properly. Intramedial nailing offers a viable alternative to plate and screw fixation, providing an equal rate of union with advantage of less invasive procedure and preventing the ugly scar of the plating. Close nailing is an art. You just do it and then you will find how it is wonderful technique to friendly to the surgeon as well as to the patient. I have published this paper with my friend Yogeshji Salpadi, he's here. A new concept in the treatment of forearm fracture with screw intramedial nail way back in 2012. I must have done now more than 300 patients of both bone forearm nailing, single isolated both bone. without repenting my results. Thank you very much. And thank you, CN Kulkarni sir, for converting me from plater to nailer. Thank you very much. And thank you, Tanna sir, for listening to me for the first time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Gadegone sir. That was a wonderful exposition of how a comprehensive fracture fixation can be done by nailing. And in your hand, it has always given a good result. I must appreciate that. Neeraj, do we have any questions right now?
Yes, sir. I have already sent in the chat.
Yeah. So, Gadegone sir, the question to you is, how do you decide the length of nail preoperatively?
In the normal side, from the tip of the ulna to the radial stylet, subtract 2 cm. And on the radius side also the same thing.
Yeah. The follow-up to this question is, do you have nail diameters of various sizes available?
Yes, it is available in the market.
What are the sizes which are available?
I use 2, 2.5, 3, 4.
Right. Tanna sir, you have any questions for Gadegone sir?
After this, I wanted to show that small video of Dr. Farke and Dr. Kulkarni's device which is there, which I just showed just now. It's a only few slides.
Okay, right. Good.
Yeah. Please share your screen, sir.
Now, how do I go there?
Yeah, you are perfect, sir. So, you go on to the panel where you see all the videos. Yes.
Yeah. Now, here is a few slides which I am showing. This is the distractor, which has been already been mentioned by Dr. Gadegone. This is the close nailing of the radius and ulna. Ajit Farke from Yavatmal and CN Kulkarni from Amravati, who is already present here. They have devised this.
Can you start the slideshow, sir? Can you start the slideshow?
Yeah, he's going on that.
There are 3 ways in which you can reduce this fracture: manual traction, Chinese finger trap with overhead traction, and shear distractor. I'm only going to talk about the shear distractor. The problems are holding the forearm steady, holding the bones in alignment, and facilitate movement of the C-arm. And that is the reason why this device is extremely useful. This is the device which has been mentioned by them. Here is the one which you are giving the... This is a crossbar securing the hand, traction device, and all these are the ones which have been there, which you will see it can be put onto the operation table. And here is this is the one way it has been put in, and there is a counter traction which is also given here, and this is the way in which it has been put in there. And you start off like this, putting it onto the hand so that everything is tied, and the hand security tried through transverse bar of the traction apparatus. Traction applied by turning the fly nuts and avoid over distraction, and it is secured to the pit table. And here it is, what you can see it very well. Here was the fracture which was not reduced. You can see the fracture is not reduced, and they are giving the gentle traction. The traction is being given just now. And you can see the fracture slowly gets reduced automatically. Slowly gets reduced automatically. And it is perfectly reduced at the end of it, so that you can do the nailing perfectly well without doing any other problem. If the other human being is giving the traction at times, it doesn't become that much. And that's the reason why this is the device which is, I feel, I am very highly impressed by it. Post-op regime, average hospital stay is 1 day. POP is left for 10 days. And cast for 6 weeks. This is advantage is simple design, fabricated locally, economical, maintenance free. And if anybody wants to contact Ajit Farke at hotmail.com or cnkulkarni1@gmail.com. It has been available by Uma Surgical. Today morning only I phoned him up. Now they're charging 1200 rupees for that. I do not get any commission from this. I'm only informing you, those who want to really have it, they are the ones who can have it from there. Okay, now you can start. Dr. Chandok, you can start.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Kulkarni, thank you very much for allowing me to share this.
One query, this distractor, you have written 12,000, but you said 1,200. It is for 1,200 or 12,000? I cannot hear you. Mute, oh, yes.
Hey, sorry, it is 12,000.
It is 12,000. Or previously, it was for 8,000 rupees only.
Yeah, when he started, it was 5,000, and with the thing escalation going on, and the popularity increasing, the rates have also increased.
And it's very useful and very comfortable to use that.
Are you also using that?
Yes, very commonly.
Very commonly. And
yeah. Are you seeing my slides, sir?
Yes. No. We are seeing you.
Okay. Okay. Are they?
Please click the green button, share the screen.
No, that is shared. Yes.
Then you have to click the PowerPoint and then share.
Then I have to click the PowerPoint, no?
Then select the PowerPoint and then share again. There is a blue button of share. Yeah. Right now we can.
Now we can see?
We can see. Now we can see.
Okay. Perfect. Thank you very much. I'll be presenting the topic forearm fracture plating tips and tricks. And the task to me is very difficult because day in and day out, I do close nailings on CA distractor. However, I'll present the point of plating. Now, we have to understand the fracture mechanisms. It is either could be axial compression, bending, rotation, or the direct trauma. The plate fixation is the gold standard for fracture management of diaphyseal fractures of forearm, basically because it takes into account tackling all these four principles and four mechanisms of injury. It is stable, strong, gives anatomical fixation, and giving a fair result in all these patients. Let us understand why plate have their own role. So in a fracture classification, the AO classification is very simple to understand here. One is humerus, two is the radius ulna, and the center is the diaphyseal is 2-2. So in 2-2A1, that is simple ulna, nothing like close nailing. 2-2A2, radius simple, but an oblique fracture, best stabilized by a plate fixation because the nailing would have very inadequate control for the obliquity of fracture. And in this patient, I would always prefer a plate fixation. Both bones simple in the middle. Yes, you can use a elastic principle of nailing or you can use a both bone forearm. There are certain advantages and disadvantages of use of either a plate or a nail. And we have to become master in choosing what we want for a given patient. For ulnar wedge, radial wedge, both bones wedge, again, either you can choose nailing principle or plate principle. For radius simple and ulna complex, these are the situations where at times a hybrid fixation may be utilized with full principle following. Ulna simple and radius complex are both bone complex. In complexities, when the complexity of fracture rises, nailing does offer advantages. Now look at these fractures. This can be nailed or this can be plated. If we want to manage them by plate fixation, we have to use a bridge principle. And with the bridge principle, if we avoid going into that zone, provide stability, good secondary callus formation would happen and the patient would have wonderful healing. This was the end result at the end of 14 weeks. In such comminuted zones, if we preserve the anatomy and the blood flow to the fragments, we can have good result. Also in various positions where there is an associated radial ulnar joint displacement, like in Montegia injury and in the distal end. So if you have a Montegia fracture, I feel plating is not only the gold standard, it is the way to go forward. Yes, certain specialized and experienced hand can manage this with close nailing if the situations are compelling, like poor soft tissue, wounds around which cannot be managed early, then is only the option of nailing is there. But otherwise, the gold standard for all these fractures of Montager injury is a plate fixation. Also, for Galizia injury, when the distal radial nerve joint is at a stay, the plate gives you three advantages. It gives complete rotational control. You can position the fracture in the position you want and then mobilize them early. That is the biggest advantage. Also, we have to consider the radiation which happens with the closed nailing principle. So in the plate fixation, the radiation is quite minimum. So there are advantages at both the ends, in Montager and in the Galizzi fracture. There, I think there is nothing like this plate fixation. It is the gold standard. Also, the plate neutralizes all the forces, whether it is oblique fracture, whether it is the joint rotation, everything is taken care. Fractures where distal radius, so imagine this fracture to be nailed. The management of a nail in a closed manner is really difficult and tough task, and even if for Dr. Gadegone, this would be very difficult. Also, this level fracture, when it is quite spiky, at times you do not get a reduction close. Nailing works fantastic when it is closed. The moment you open it, the result of healing and the union time required is same for nail or a plate, with a better union rate with plate if you don't get any infection. So why plate? In such a fracture, you may combine principle of a closed nail for the ulna and plate for the radius, but the principles used are different, and in essentially this patient, you would need help of a plaster to stabilize the ulna. Now we have to understand these various joints, why plate is considered as a gold standard. Five joints: humero-ulnar, radiocapitular, proximal radio-ulnar, distal radio-ulnar, and radiocarpal. And this is resulting into the elbow flexion and extension. Proximal radio-ulnar and distal radio-ulnar are responsible for pronosupination, and therefore, and the unique functional anatomy. Remember, the radius rotates on the ulna, and this is restored completely, and we have a wonderful forearm rotation. Imagine two sticks side by side, and if you want to have rotation beyond 130 degree, this is possible only with the typical bowing of both the bones. They adapt to each other, and this is crucial. At times in closed nailing, wonderfully done, we are not able to completely restore the bowing. The patient's functional results are fine, but in those patients where they do not get adapted, then we have no solution for that. And in that patient and these patients, I feel plating does give the wonderful response. Now the plating in such fractures. Here, if I try to do this closed nail, yes, we are able to get the medullary cannulation by the nail, but the plating restores the bow fantastically. Special anatomy of all our forearm muscles. We all know that there are strong muscles which make rotationally the nail fixation unstable. The articular synergy, restoration of articular anatomy, absolute stability, and early functional rehab is all possible with plate fixation. There are these five consequences of forces which are deforming. Shortening, taken care of by plate. Angulation, taken care of by plate. Loss of radial bow, fantastic way it can tackle the loss of bow, and we can restore moments to the fullest extent. The investigation routinely we do for a plate or a nail is all of us would do. CT has a limited role only when there is articular involvement, and the indications of operative treatment, this are definitely there, and this all can be managed by plate fixation. The operative approaches which you take for plate, all of us know this AO drawings, and the approaches are very well given, and all the AO literature has for proximal radius, when we go proximally, anteriorly, we have to take care of the recurrent radial artery, and we have to coagulate them to avoid inadvertent compartment syndrome. So all these approaches are very well given in the books. We have to just master them so that we effectively plate our patients in a biological fashion. We do not destroy. The only thing you need to open is 1/3 part of the radius to put your plate. Do not devitalize completely. Do not devitalize with periosteum elevator circumferentially. And then we can have a good result with plating. The ulnar approach is quite fairly simple. It is directly onto the cutaneous border of ulna. That is quite simple. So all of us would master this. We have to judge whether we provide a nail fixation or a plate fixation. Soft tissues, degree of fracture displacement, comminution, joint involvement, and all these factors come into play whether to choose a nail or a plate. In such a bad soft tissue, either you wait and plate or you can do with a closed nail immediately. So for a lot of comminution, I usually prefer a nailing principle, which becomes biological. And if there is a problem, that can be managed by further treatment. So friends, if you want to have anatomical reduction, good restoration of radial ulnar length, we want to stabilize the joint properly and rotational alignment, plate is the answer. And the reduction principles we have to follow. This restoration of bow is the main element which is important in the plate fixation. The operative approaches we have already seen. When we do a closed nail, the bow is a problem. And at times when I commonly do a nail also, I would manage a bow by apparatus, which is very simple, so that we manage the bowing. For plating reduction, there are certain tips and tricks. We can have a push or pull technique of plate fixation. We can use in a comminuted zone a distractor. This is a small distractor zone. We can use a large distractor. This I find very useful for an oblique fracture plane fixation. Also, we have to leave the comminution zone. I like to use this point clamp, which is quite biological. The large prongs are not there, so that we do not destroy the periosteum on the opposite side of the fracture. The reduction techniques, if done indirect, gives a good result in plating. Also, when there is an oblique fracture, this clamp uses the oblique plane nicely and it holds very nicely. I also like to modify certain plate designs. So if there is a comminution zone, usually we find the plate may have giving way there. So instead of a single gap or a double gap, I may keep a triple gap also ready, and that helps us. This point Weber's reduction clamp helps to neutralize the oblique fracture effectively. Also, I would like to use bone spikes, which are very small and with less amount of spike, so that it doesn't pierce the intraosseous membrane. So friends, we can effectively stabilize the fracture both bone forearm. And if you follow the principle, depending on the type of fracture, then the results of plating are equally good or rather more better. In multi-fragmentary, complicated and compound fractures, we may take use of the external fixator also. But for this fracture, I feel the most effective way to stabilize this is a radial 7-hole or 8-hole plate. And that gives an effective compression in transverse fracture. Friends, a plate, one disadvantage is more prone for infections. And like in this simple fracture, the surgeon did the plating and that required revision with bone cement and antibiotic masculate technique and then reparation of the process. In oblique plane management, this requires additional skills. You can obliquely lag it and then plate onto the radial border. Implant customization and improvisation does help in plate fixation, and we need to keep our full armor of plates assorted available so that we do not lag the adequate size on a given time. Friends, for removal of plate or nail, we can have difficulties. I feel even up to 3 years, 4 years, plate removal is more easier than the nail. Nail you need to remove as early as union has happened. If there is a tight forearm nail removal, which we find quite difficult, we may require to explore the nail and then remove. One of the apparatus which is very easy and I like is the NL6. This is a hardware item and very comfortable. Also, Shirsagar now provides either a forearm extractor set and also the Ender's nail extractor set, which can create a thread onto the lost thread of the nail. And then you can hammer it out in this device. this is how it can be worked, and this helps in taking out the nail difficulties. So both plate may be difficult to remove, nail also can be difficult to remove. If you want to provide removal, provide them early. The plate, one of the difficulties is after removal of plate, at times a stress riser phenomena can happen and patient may have a stress fracture, which is not usually found in the nail removal. This is the difficulty with the simple stainless steel removal things. They get widened, therefore have a good firm grip of NL6. This is a simple hardware item. This is chrome vanadium and it works fantastic. Friends, I found this complication after doing plate, that this was a patient of head injury, though there is a synostosis. So synostosis can also happen in plate. So plating also has its own share of complication, and we have to be watchful for complication. Again, nail or plate, choice is yours. Provide stability, provide rotational control, use what is good, giving good result in your hand. If you follow principles for nail, that gives good function. I like to avoid a nerve impingement whenever you are taking an entry point. Use biological methods to stabilize with the plate. Plate, when you do with minimum periosteal stripping, careful handling of the soft tissue, extremely careful while handling a butterfly, we can give a good result. These are my tips for effective result after surgery. Begin with the easiest fracture. Look for elbow and wrist joint. Obtain complete synergy. Be aware of rotation of radius and the bow. Test function of forearm joint just after fixation. At the end, the distal radial ulnar joint should be well located. Obtain perfect reduction, perfect rotation and bow. You will have wonderful result. Thank you. Thank you very much. If there are any questions, or otherwise, the Tanna sir can go for his talk and then we can have questions.
So there are some questions on the chat. Dr. Yogesh, can you tell them?
Am I audible, Neeraj?
Yes. We can listen to you.
Yeah. Dr. Gadegone, there is a question from Dr. Nitin Deshpande. He says that sometimes when one bone nailing is done, it is very easy. But when you are trying to nail the other bone, it is difficult, or it simply doesn't come to get aligned. So do you have any tricks for it?
What you have to do, you can use a percutaneous K wire.
Okay.
So opposite forces you can bring into alignment. And if it is not possible by K wire, you can pass a percutaneous towel clips also, but it is dangerous not to put the towel clip unless you are experienced with this. Or you give a very small incision. Don't hesitate to give a very small incision and then align the fragment and do anything. So if you are able to do it a closed method, it is good. By any methods, you can use it. But K wire manipulation is the best to align the fracture fragment.
My suggestion here is, can I speak, Yogesh?
Yes, sir, please.
See, I think it was when he mentioned Gadegone that the well-reduced fracture you wire first. Then the other, which has been overlapping, generally it is damn difficult to really put a wire there to reduce there. So my suggestion is exactly the other way around. The one which is well-reduced, you know very well that the soft tissue envelope is all intact. And when you can, you want to really distract, when the whole radius is well reduced, but the ulna is not well reduced, you will be able to distract the ulna out, and you will be able to reduce that ulna first, pass the wire first into the ulna, and then still the radius will not get displaced. Because if it is not displaced from beginning, that means the soft tissues are intact. Yes. And you will be able to put it back, that radius, and put the radius back. And I think this is what I was even talking to about in the pediatricians also. And exactly the same thing they mentioned about that first, try to do the unreduced fracture, and then you will be able to do the distraction, and then only you do the reduced fracture.
Wonderful. Neeraj, yes? can I add on that?
Yes.
Yeah. Dr. Deshpande mentioned a difficult reduction. So what I would do, if you want to do it close, away from the fracture site for around, say, 1 inch away from the fracture site, you have a 1 centimeter to 1.5 centimeter nick on the superficial border of ulna, and put small clamps. Then you have a distracting force available to distract it out. If it is not done closed, as Tanna sir said, if it can be managed by the CA distractor or any distraction manual, that is fine. In case it's still not coming and the fracture is spiky, then you can hold it with two clamps and distract it. So it is not opening the fracture, but putting the clamp and getting distraction. That way is manageable.
Yeah.
You have other questions?
Yes, Dr. Gadegone, what is an absolute indication in the forearm fracture for plating?
For plating, the ends of the bone. Ends of the bone, like Montage, Gallage fracture, though I do nailing, but I prefer, and it is a gold standard treatment. And fracture near the joint, they don't come very well with the nailing, because there is so much disparity between the canal and the nail that doesn't fix it. Therefore, at the ends of the bones, the plating is the gold standard.
Gadegone sir, do you keep plate as an option on table?
Yes, yes, always.
But hardly ever he uses it.
That is it. But always, always.
Same question is asked to Dr. Chandra. What is his absolute indication for plating as well as nailing? Dr. Shivshankar is asking.
Yeah, the absolute indication for plate is Montage fracture, Galizia fracture is their absolute indications. And irreducible fracture in a closed nail is again a good indication for plate, because if you are opening, it is always better to do with a plate fixation. So these are absolute indications.
There's also one question from a delegate. In the proximal radius fracture, you always go volar from volar side?
Yeah, I always prefer a volar side, because then you are going from one side of the supinator so that you are not at risk of injuring the posterior interosseous nerve. Always volar.
Is there any video of yours you can share with all of us that that will help us, the delegates also, for?
Yes, I'll share the email ID and I'll transfer the video. No problem.
Thank you, sir. So nice, sir.
I think the easiest approach is that anterior Henry's approach.
Henry's approach, yes.
You go up to the tendon of the biceps.
Yeah.
Once you go up to the tendon of the biceps, you cut in the line of tendon of the biceps, and then you go and you will be able to take the supinator away and you will not damage the posterior interosseous nerve. And that is the easiest way where you can do the proximal radius plating.
Absolutely, sir. And two or three important points are, we are in between the plane of brachioradialis and the radial artery and nerve. We are more medial. The incision is more medial anteriorly than what is usually imagined. And it is a long extensile approach, but it's a wonderful approach.
And at that place, there are a few leases of few vessels are there, which you will have to coagulate.
Ligulate, yeah. Those are important points.
Yeah, there is a question from Dr. Dixit from Chandrapur for Dr. Chandak.
Yes.
You mentioned the rising incidence of a refracture following plate removal.
Yes.
So apart from the stress hyzer effect, which happens after removal of multiple screws and the plate, there is also a concern about the periosteal stripping, which occurs at the time of surgery, about which nothing has been mentioned on the operative notes anytime.
Yes.
So, and preferably the diameters of the screw, because many a time the surgeon struggles while doing a longer span of the plate. So what is your take on that? That's number one. And the incidence of refractures following even a locking compression plate also is more or less the same. So what's your say on this?
Yes, very important, pertinent question he has put in. The incidence of stress rising after a plate removal is definitely there. One, either it can be detected on table. If detected, you can splint it again either with the plate, extended plate or a nail. Or if it is detected late, then it's a real problem, because the patient is not in a happy mood to tolerate that situation. The incidence is more if the screw removal was particularly difficult or plate had to be hammered out to be removed. So we have to be careful for this removal. Ideally, when there is no indication, no pain, and patient's plate is sitting well without any problem, no chance of a metallosis from a good implant, I would not advocate removal of a plate. But if the need to be, it is to be removed, take precautions. Whether locking plate is removed or a non-locking construct is removed, the incidence of stress rising effect is same. And I had to manage myself a couple of patients of stress rising after a plate removal, which we have to again either splint it with a nail or a plate.
Chandak sir.
Yes, sir.
And the plate removal. Plate removal should not be done early enough. Because when, yes, particularly when you are expecting a primary healing, when you've done the compression, that, yes, compression to become a solid, it takes a longer time. So yes, even 1 year is a little too early to remove the plate when you're treated with compression. If you've done a spacer plate and it's going to heal up with the callus formation, then there is no problem. But yes, if you are expecting a primary union, and it always, if you're good compression you've done, you'll always feel it is united. But it is, that takes a longer time to become consolidation. So in a primary healing, which you are expecting in compression, you shouldn't remove it for around 2 years.
Absolutely, sir.
Sir, Chandak, sir.
And the second thing which I want to comment on.
Yes, sir.
Somebody, you asked just now, Yogesh, you asked the things about the soft tissue stripping.
Stripping.
Yeah. In a plating, you don't do a soft tissue stripping. The fracture itself, whatever the periosteum, it is stripped up. From that area only you hold, that area only you reduce. And very rightly, Dr. Chandak has mentioned, you make a cut just enough for you to put in the plate so that all the muscle supply from the around and everything is intact. Don't hold the two bones with the clamps. Don't hold two bones with the clamps and try to reduce them. Do it with the arteries and just reduce it. And it is the only way to reduce it.
Yes. Chandak, sir.
Yes, sir, please.
Suppose if there is a stress fracture detected after 1 month of the removal of the plate.
Yes, sir.
And the fracture is in good position and patient, yes, refused for surgery. Is there any chance of healing by plaster?
We have had patient where there were a lot of concerns in the mind of patient and they were not willing for surgery. Those fractures healed up, but some amount of angulation happened. So I would always advise the patient can be convinced to go ahead with the fixation.
Do you advise bone grafting along with this stress fracture or only the re-fixation?
If I am myself doing it, I would always like to do it bone grafting at the same moment, because the union process would be hastened with the addition of bone graft.
If there is a second operation, don't hesitate to put the bone graft. Whether it is really required theoretically, whether it is hypertrophic fractures and everything, I think it's a very dicey thing.
Yes, agreed, sir. Absolutely agree. Yes, Neeraj, any other question, Yogesh?
Yeah, there is a question which has come up. In a good canal space, a well-contoured 3 or a 3.5 millimeter of an ender nail can maintain a radial bow, give a good rotational stability, and lead to early union due to micro motion. Now the question is how to take out the second nail when two nails are put in a radius.
Gadegone sir,
yes.
Question to you. Huh. Ever you use Ender's nail?
We never use Ender's nail. Ender's nail is a stiffer construct and it has got a particular configuration. So therefore, Ender's nail is ruled out in the fracture both bone forearm.
Nene, but Gadegone, when you use the second nail,
yes, sir,
in order to correct that displacement, and I'm sure that is not your nail, you are not using it. You are using it to some either a Enders or a wire or something.
Yes, rush nail mostly.
Mostly rush nail, yeah.
So yeah, what you do, because I am using a screw intramedial nail, it is there, serrations are there, so I can catch it up and by unturn, I can remove. First, I remove the screw intramedial nail. And then the other nail.
Gadegone sir, are you not concerned with the cumulative amount of radiation you are having? This is one of the surgeon who has asked.
Yes, there is. Because in initial phases, there are some problems of radiation. But with the, as you progress and your technique is improved, probably you don't require so much radiation.
Average number of shoots per nailing procedure?
5 to 6 for radius and 4 to 5 for ulna.
Okay. And how do you bend your nail? That is always a million-dollar question and I have not been able to figure it out how to bend the nail to get a radial bow. Any tricks for that?
Actually, This is a arbitrary bending. You cannot exactly bend the nail as you are in the radius. But what happens if it is a 2.5 mm nail and 2 mm nail, they are fits into the radial canal of the radius and they take the shape of that radius. That is my observation.
Okay. And that is the reason exactly what was asked by Dr. Yogesh.
Yeah.
If it is an endless nail, then it will take the shape of the radius and you will almost always be having the bow which is restored. And even if you can put in a slightly thicker nail, if the thinner nail is big enough, if it is not big enough, you can change it and you can put in a thicker nail. I have no issues. I try to use only the endless type of a nail nowadays. And it is also an imported one and it is not stiff. It is slightly more flexible.
So you have used it and you have had a good result of bow?
Nowadays I use an endless only.
Okay. That's a good input actually. We never tried endless nail. So Gadegone sir, in spite of your rich experience, you have something to take home here.
Yes, yes. I will try imported endless nail.
Sir, there is one more question. Can we have it, Neeraj?
Bolo.
Yes.
There is a question in a comminuted fracture. How do you access the correct rotation? This is a question to both the speakers, Dr. Chandak as well as Dr. Gadegone. In a comminuted fracture, how do you determine about the rotation?
So I am being ruled out. There is no question to me.
please.
So I think the best person to answer this question is Tanna, sir.
Nay. If your question is asked to you.
Gadegone, sir, you are going, how do you manage the rotation in a comminuted fracture?
In comminuted fracture, actually, before going its last threads, what I compare with the opposite side.
So how do you take the CM to the opposite side?
I bring that forearm to that particular level. It is very easy because that is a free head.
Okay.
So therefore, you can compare, but it is very difficult, as he said. Probably Tanna sir may throw some light on it.
As I imagine, in a comminuted fracture, what you do is always take supination as the final answer.
Yes.
Yes, exactly. In supination, whatever it is, keep the radial bow and you plate it. In a way, few long plate without a few screws above and below.
Yeah.
I generally don't do a badly comminuted fracture and nailing. I feel probably it is chances of non-union are a little higher. Yeah.
Okay.
Dr. Tanna sir, there is one question about the statement which you had just given. Hello?
Yes. Go ahead.
Yeah. How can we clear the soft tissue in the fracture side on both the ends without elevating the fracture ends with clamps as told by you?
No, I think once you enter the fracture, you know the one day the fracture has occurred, it is displaced, part of the periosteum has already been displaced. So all what you need to do is to really clear it out with the scoop on two ends. This is all what you need to do. You don't need to do anything else at all. And then you really reduce it and compress it.
Okay.
I think it is a myth that if you have to do a plating, you have to remove a lot of soft tissue. And in a nailing, you don't have to do it. Uh-huh. As a matter of fact, the damage which has already, the trauma has occurred. Same trauma damage, you can do almost the same plating. You can do it with the same amount of minimal periosteal elevation, which always occurs after a fracture, which is a displaced.
All right.
Yeah.
So there is a question for Dr. Gadegone, sir.
Yes.
When you are doing a nailing, is it wise enough to pass a narrow reduction nail beforehand? And once you have adequately maneuvered that nail into the distal fragment, pass a second, a little bigger diameter nail, which will...
You can do that. For ulna nailing, I always do a rim nailing. Okay. For radius only, I do unrim nailing. So that I know with the rimming, what is the size of the nail required for the... radius, ulna. For radius, it is just a eyeballing. First type of a nail is I will put a first 2.5. If it is going very easily, then I may replace it by 3. Suppose 2.5 doesn't go with easily, then I may reduce it to 2. So below 2 mm, I had never done it.
Okay.
Below 2 mm, if it is required, then it is better to do plating.
And how do you rim it? You have those small remus, is it? Yes, you got the forearm remus.
Yes.
And you will only ream the proximal fragment.
Far ulnar isthmus reaming.
And Gadegone sir, you did not show any case of a reamer broken inside. There must be some.
Because the reamer, when it is smaller, say it is 1.5, then it is a little more flexible. Yes. Once it becomes 2, it becomes slightly more stiffer. And 2.5 reamer almost becomes a stiff reamer. Reamer I am talking, not the name.
Yes. Yes.
So I think if you are reaming it with 2.5, then probably you will not be able to go further in the radius, particularly. Ulna is a straight bone. You will be able to go. That's the reason probably in the radius you are not reaming at all.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, so I think, Yogesh, we can take up rest of the question after the talk of Tanna, sir.
Please.
So, Tanna, we can have, Tanna, sir, can we request you to share your screen? You can go ahead with your presentation, sir.
Share.
Sir, your sharing is on. Just start the PowerPoint. Sharing is on.
Yes. This is my golf course, which I'm missing it. Lovely things with the beautiful flowers, which we see around there. And here is a different season. You see the different flowers. Then you can see some of those golfers. We are moving there. I miss it. It's lovely to be there. Now we talk about why the failures occur in forearm fractures and how to handle and how to avoid. I'm going to talk about all those things. Most are day one failure. Orthopedics is all mechanics. I think you heard beautifully Dr. Gadegone and Dr. Chandok just now. Unless you handle the mechanics, you will not be able to really do orthopedics. And we must understand how they work. Now here, you cannot use the thin nail. You cannot use a reconstruction plate for this sort of a fracture. It's too thin. It's bound to break here. That reconstruction nail, which we used to occasionally use it in park, is not the ideal one. And when you should never have a screw inside the fracture, no screw nearer the fracture. All these are the things which we know about it till we get this again and again. Is bound to fail there. Interfragmental screw, smaller size, 2 millimeter, short oblique, avoid at the end of the bone. This is the slide which I show every time. If it is a short oblique fracture, never put a leg screw. You put a leg screw here, I have put in a leg screw. You can see the things here, I had done it myself. You can see this fragment. This is the leg screw which has been put in, and this ultimately becomes end up, and you will see the sequestrum. So end of the bone really dies out. So never put in a short oblique, never put in a leg screw, always a compression. You can see here, when you put in the screw, this fragment is very small fragment and it will not last. And you will always have ischemia of that area. The small butterfly, loose without soft tissue, remove it and graft it. Small with a good soft tissue, do not touch, no spike around. Exposure, minimally invasive, we have already just now spoken about. And I use it if I do a plating. The drilling which you do it into the flutes, you will be able to collect a reasonably good amount of a graft from these flutes. From 6 holes if you do it, six holes minimum you put the plate. So you will be able to use a reason about, there are some graft which remains here also in the hole which you drill, and there is always with the needle or with the K wire, you take out this from the flutes graft, and at the end of it, there is a reasonable amount of a graft which is there. So if ever there is any comminution while you are doing the plating, you can put the graft there. And now here is the fracture, which is so nearby, and you are putting such a small fracture over here. This goes into non-union. And all what you need to do, this is the one. All which you need to do, this goes into non-union because the screws are too near. All what you need to do is don't put the 2 screws nearby and compress the fracture. You compress the fracture heals up perfectly well. I don't think it's a very difficult situation. You can use it with the DCP holes, 1 or 2, whichever way you want to do it. But the compression is a must for these fractures. and this is the only way in which you win. Again, this you can see the screw. Screw is so near the fracture. Again, all these things can be treated with the thing. You can see it over here again. This is the small screw. This is the small screw. Again, you change it. Leave the area open, comminuted area open. Don't put any screws anywhere in between. And then the fracture heals up. And the six-hole plate, to me, doesn't exist. You cannot use a six-hole plate anywhere. This is a six-hole plate, and it is a thin Indian six-hole plate, which bends, and it doesn't give you enough fixation. So always an eight-hole plate or a 10-hole plate, if in case the fracture needs it. And do not put two holes in between the fracture. Don't put screws in that. So I never use a six-hole plate. Minimum is an eight-hole. Keep two holes near the fracture MP. And here is, if no pain, one can wait the fracture healing. Here was the fracture. There was a necrosis occurred, but the patient came and he says, I have no pain, sir. But the X-ray, I didn't like it. So I at one stage considered about the grafting. But with my past experience, if the patient does not have a pain, but the radiology is like this, you can wait. And I waited. And the fracture heals up. So this is the one which occurs at the end of the bone, the necrosis occurs. And this necrosis occurs. And if it is a good stability, which is already there, then the fracture will again heal up. You don't have to put a bone graft. If I had put a bone graft, probably I would have said it has healed up because of bone graft. But this is not because of the bone graft. This is healed up because it was supposed to heal up and it has healed up automatically. In such a comminuted fracture, such fracture will always do a plating. I would not like to do a nailing for such comminuted fracture. Always do a plating and you will be able to see the healing occurring. So excellent healing and everything will be maintained. Now, in this sort of a fracture, this is the borderline. More often plating in a radius type, I will nail. But otherwise, I will plate. But as you can see here, you can do this plate. You can do this plate here without any problem. But now, today, I will probably nail it. This is in past when I think I was a plater. And these two people changed me from plating to nailing. One is Dr. C.N. Kulkarni in Amravati. And other is Dr. Chandok. When I went to Nagpur, he had laid down 3, 4, 5 cases. Sir, why are you talking about plating all the time? This is the nailing which is we have done and this is all right. So both of them changed my approach. And today, I am a nailer more than a plater. There are two-part fracture. Transverse fracture fixed always either with a compression or a DCP or with the leg, never without either. And the leg is only if it is a long oblique. Short oblique, don't leg it. Again, I'll say. Comminuted fracture, plate is in neutralization, adjust all fragments indirectly in line with traction and fix away from the fracture. Do not hold the clamps on both the sides and that fracture will heal up. All what you need is 3 screws above, 3 screws below in a long plate. Probably I'll come. And the leg screw. Leg screw, as all of us, you know, this is the leg screw. And general observation is leg screw is hardly needed in forearm as it is mostly a short oblique fracture and fracture is very small. So I hardly ever need. Now here some surgeon has done the leg screw and you can see the leg screw and then he has done the nailing and this has gone into trouble. So in a forearm fractures, leg screw is except in one case which was shown by Dr. Chandok, long oblique, then you can do a leg screw, otherwise not a leg screw. And on a leg screw, I have been talking about it again and again. If you do a leg screw, do it properly. Most of the people answer when I tell them that they will put a first 2.5 drill first, and then they will put a 3.5 drill to increase the near extent. This is not right. This is what will happen. And then there will be the fracture will reduce. The whole reduction will be lost. So it has to be first a 3.5, and then put in a drill sleeve, and then put in a 2.5. So this screw should not touch the near fragment at all. This is what we have been talking about. Again and again, I've been speaking about it. But I feel again and again, people talk the same thing. And in the radius, in order to get the radius bow, you'll have to get a template and put the template, and then you will be able to get the radial bow there. This is the only way in which you can do it. And the compression with the DCP holes. Now, I'm showing these slides only because it is every time we show this, but this is in an imported plate. In an Indian plate, this design of the screw, every company is not perfect. So even if you do the screw eccentric in an Indian plate, you will not get compression. So don't be under illusion that just because you've done eccentric plating, you got the compression. You can use a Muller device, you can use a Weber device, you can do any other device which you like. But the compression, this is the primary healing which occurs. Now in this sort of a fracture, when this is what I was talking about, when you remove the plate, this takes a long time to consolidate. You can see here, there is a sclerosis there, till the medullary cavity is not established. At this stage, you cannot remove the plate. I think you should be very careful that slowly when the medullary cavity is established, that is the time you can probably remove the plate. And here, I may do nailing in this fracture today, but this is what was done, the plating, and everything has become all right. This is in my old times when I used to do the plating all the time, and this is what I used to do. Nailing problems, they are relative. Magician Gadegone, there is no contraindication for nailing in any fracture. I'm sure he'll do everyone. Now here in a short oblique, no leg, always a compression. And I always ask this, how do you do a compression in the short oblique fracture? With the plate, you do a compression. If you do a compression, you put in the first screw into the acute hole and you do the compression, this is going to slide down. So when you do it, when you're getting this compression with Muller or DCP or anything, it will slide down. So in this is an acute angle. Do not start first screw in the acute angle, but you start first screw in the obtuse angle. If you do it in first screw in the obtuse angle, this is the obtuse angle. Then you do the compression. Now you will be able to get a perfect compression done. So if you want to do compression, learn how to do compression. Just do it from any side you put in the screw and other side you compress, you will not get a perfect reduction. This is the typical way. In an acute angle, you can't get it. In an obtuse angle, you will get perfect reduction. Now in a fracture, this was shown by Gadegone. Probably he, as I said, he is a magician. I have learned today that you can put in a second wire and probably you can reduce here. This went into non-union. This went into non-union. And ultimately, it had to be done with the plating and compression, and it would heal up perfectly well. And here was the fracture, where this is a small, thin plate which is put. You can see this is the fracture, and this thin reconstruction plate is not a proper plate. This plate will not be able to hold it, and it has been put onto this side. So now, how do you handle this? Any idea, Dr. Gadegone, Dr. Chandok, how will you handle this non-union?
We'll remove this reconstruction nail because already the radial head is excised. So I will do a nailing and bone grafting.
Chandok, what would you like to do in this upper ulna?
Yeah, I'll have a long plate. I'll long incision, a hook plate onto the proximal ulna and long bridge mode and putting bone grafts, lot of bone grafts on both the sides. That would be
See, I feel that here when we do the plating, this is the plating is done onto this dorsal side. So I do this plating on the side here so that you can put the plate on the side because there is enough three holes proximal, three holes distally, and you can have a bicortical hole. So you can have a bicortical hole, you have a stable fixation there. I'm talking about this fracture which is slightly lower down. For this thing, you can do this bicortical hold into the plate after compression. This took a 7.5 months and ultimately it healed up very well. And here was the fracture in 7 months' time. Fracture is completely healed up and you can see there is an excellent supination pronation is still restored. So this is the one which I have always been doing it, that you do it on the side. Do not do it onto the dorsum, but do it on the side, you will be able to get that situation there. And here is the other fracture. This was the 34-year-old fresh fracture. It had gone into this. I feel olecranon plate is not thick enough for this fracture. This is almost a, it is a fracture in the diaphysis. It's not a metaphyseal fracture. For the fracture olecranon plate, somewhere fracture here, it is all right. Okay, here at this level. But at this level, olecranon plate I find is too thin. That's the reason it broke down. So here also, I did the same thing. The side plate, three screws proximally, four screws I could put proximally, compress the fracture. So side plate, and you could get the fracture completely healed up. 3.5 DCP with both cortices screw, I feel is a better construct in this area. So few mantras in forearm fractures. Proximal ulna and distal one-third. Here you got to be careful. Olecranon plate is not good enough, and the nailing is not good enough for the radius, unless you are Gadegone. Now this is what the surgeon did for the ulna non-union. Now this is what ultimately became like this, from here to here, and this is when I took over, and here was the thing. Original x-rays were like this. The patient had done the wiring, so I presume because the K-wire in the joint stabilizer is a Montage variety with the head radius fracture, olecranon fracture, cannot explain the K-wire, maybe elbow dislocation. So this was the first operation, and it excised the radius. And then here it was, this broke down. This broke down. So again, now how will you do? Unless I think I have presented it earlier. If any one of you have known about it, you are disqualified. If you haven't known about it, you are allowed to talk. Anybody wants to opine? Dr. Nitin, you want to opine on this?
Sir, it is a non-union as well as there is a fracture of coronoid there. It is like a terrible trial.
No, but it is gone. Now it is old. Now the elbow is stable. Now we are not talking about the elbow. Now it is only the only the non-union here.
Yeah.
Because elbow is a stable elbow.
Yeah, we need to fix with a hook plate as well as anatomical reconstruction of ulna and with plenty of bone grafts.
Yeah.
Okay, Dr. Gadegone. So sorry, Dr. Chandok, you raised your hand.
Yeah, I think I would.
You are sure you haven't seen this earlier? No, where no, I presented no. it many times.
No. This patient here, the proximal hold is poor. So here I would like to use an orthogonal construct in two different planes. And then that would give a proper stability to fractures.
Okay, this is how it was treated. And this is the stage I took over. Now here it is where 1 year, 8 months, third surgery, this is how it is. This is the stage I came into picture. Now proceed.
So I will try to reconstruct with a fibula. I will take a fibula and a long plate from olecranon to the midshaft of the ulna. That will be my planning with cortico-cancellous graft added.
And you will put the fibula where? Intramedullary.
Intramedullary.
So in this ulna, which is a small ulna, how much you will have to cut the fibula almost?
You have to cut the fibula. We have to make it a size in. And then half of the inside and half you can put it on the outside also.
Okay. Anybody else wants to suggest anything?
Sir, fibula is according to me.
Sorry.
Yeah, though I would want to remove this and check, is there any infection?
No. I'm not hiding anything.
Achha, there is no infection right now.
No.
Okay. And what is his movement?
Elbow is very stiff. Very little movement.
So I feel that I would want to remove this and do that side plate thing.
Sorry, you want to do what?
I want to remove this.
Yes.
Do a tricortical graft and that side plate which you showed, the plate from the other side.
Okay. Now here was that. Once we removed, you can see the radius has also gone there. This is how it was when everything was removed. This is the stage where it was there. When I came over, here it is a non-union. I inherited mainly at this stage. I presume the same thing. Anybody wants to change any opinion now seeing these bones? Okay. So this from there, I put in the plate, olecranon plate, and a fibula here. Fibula here. Because I felt this was too small a thing to put the fibula there. So I put in all of this. This is what 12 months. The fracture is completely healed up. As you can see here, it is completely healed up. I'll come out the fibula. But there was a skin problem here. You can see the olecranon plate is seen here. Because by multiple surgeries, this is what happened. Now what?
Would require a flap transposition there?
What do you think? If a flap transposition, sorry. Okay. So here it is. This is how it was. So all I wanted to do was I removed the plate. I removed the plate. I called the plastic surgeon at the time of removal of the plate. And you can see while removing the plate, there was a tension band also was added along with the plate and the fibula. And you can see this is the fibula. This is the right white fibula, but this was absolutely stuck to the bone.
Yes.
And there were the screws which I had put in the fibula, which I am taking out that screws from the fibula. And this is what is the fibula which is there, which was put on the side. It has consolidated everything completely. This is how it is consolidated. You can see the whole thing completely. This is the range of movement. And the plastic surgeon said, once you remove the plate, and then only by dressing, this is what is going to heal up. And fortunately, it healed up. I thought I had called him for a flap. So I was quite surprised when he said, no, sir, once you remove the plate, there will be enough space there and this will heal up. So it healed up ultimately. And you can see here the range of movement, the things here, this is completely healed up here. And here is the x-ray, fast x-ray. Obviously, there is no supination, pronation, everything is into that. This is the range of movement he has got. This is the range of movement and here is the skin. After 5 years of total injury, this is where it is healed up. And now he came in for me for a supination pronation. Saba bhi wo supination pronation karo. But maaf karo, that is the end of the story. And this is how it has become. So I think in 22 months, ultimately this has become all right. Now here I am trying to show the video of a shingling. When we do the non-union, we have to do the shingling properly. This is what is the shingling. This is the non-union. And you can see all the soft tissues are being kept and osteoperiosteal flap is taken out from the side. You can see there is an osteoperiosteal flap which is taken out.
Yes.
This is the typical non-union surgery I'm showing. So you can see the soft tissue is there all around. And the bone is becoming now it has to be opened out. The medullary cavity is to be opened out. Now you can see line. So that there, once it is in the line, otherwise it will penetrate. So you got to see that it is absolutely in the line. It is the smallest drill. You go there, if you don't get a resistance, slowly you go in, now you get this owl, open up the medullary cavity. And really freshen the part. You can see with the nibbler, I am freshening the part. This is typical shingling, I think, which is every non-union I do it. Subperiosteal, there is a whole flap because that is where the union starts. Union doesn't start from the end. I open up the medullary cavity and everywhere. So that will contribute to it. Now I'm reducing it. As you can see, it is being reduced by cross holding it. And there it is reduced. There you can see. It is now reduced. And now you get confirmed it is reduced. And so now it is plated and now it is grafted. The grafting should go all that shingled area underneath that muscle. It should go right there, about an inch and a half proximally and distally all around. So this is what is the grafting which is done. Now grafting is done also on the opposite side. And in the hole, whatever there is, the small fracture, there also there is the grafting which is done. This is the typical grafting which we do it. And then, so I feel that this is the typical non-union surgery of any bone, which is the one which you have to continue doing it. Now here was one case which I am trying to show. Unless and until this Bengal view which was taken second time. Am I heard? Am I being heard?
Yes, sir. We are hearing you.
Yeah. Here was the fractured forearm.
Yes.
Because my internet is not working adequately.
It's yes.
Here.
Yeah.
Now there was a scaphoid fracture, which as I mentioned to you, in the scaphoid fracture which was there, which could have been missed by accidentally the view became in between the
bangles.
Yes. And that is the one way how it was picked up. Yeah. I think there is something, my internet is slow. Something is happening to the internet. Now here is the typical,
if you can just
see the typical square nail.
Yes.
Which, now you can see that this is the nail which broke down. This is the nail. You can see initially all of us felt this is infected. But you can see there is a nail erosion which is seen here. This is typical, all of us feel infected, but I said no, this I have seen it earlier. This is the typical metal reaction. This is a metal reaction. So when we went in, this is a typical cheesy material. All that dirty material came out. All this is the dirty material which is coming out of that. And that part of the bone which was loose, it came out. And we couldn't remove this nail. So obviously there was nothing I could do it. I put it up with the hydroxyapatite. Completely it was filled up there. And fortunately, here was the material which was all scooped out and all. And everything settled down. And you can see ultimately the pain and everything also went away. Fortunately, these are the nails which probably you people have not done it in nowadays. All this is the one which was done earlier, where the metal which was used was not the proper metal. So this was the square nail which was done of a metal which would give these reactions. Here are the other x-rays of the metal, forearm metal. You can see all these are the reactions. You can see them very well. All these are the metal reactions which has occurred. So this is occasionally you see this metal reaction, fracture heals up, but you can see the metal reaction, patient gets a pain, and only when you remove the metal, the pain goes away. And this is the typical one where again there was a metal reaction which was there and I could do the whole thing. These are all typical metal reactions which you can see. So in conclusion, small leg screw in a long oblique only, preferably 2 millimeter screw. Short oblique, use a compression and not a leg screw. Thicker plate, never a Recon plate. Recon plate is not indicated here. Avoid screw nearer the fracture. 8-hole plate, never 6-hole plate. Put screws, leave 4th and 5th hole free. Don't come nearer the fracture at all. This is the only way in which you can get the fracture healed up. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for solving all those complications associated with either nail or plate and bailing us out through very difficult situations. I presume that there are many questions. Yogesh, you can shoot the questions now.
May I ask a question to sir?
Yes, sir, please go ahead.
सर
जरा 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 बहुत 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 डिफिकल्ट मत पूछो हमको.
अच्छा जी. In a proximal ulna, if there is a roomy canal is there and there is a cancellation, is it possible to do a nail and plate combination for non-union plus bone grafting?
No, I feel I will do a compression plate. I am very comfortable with the compression plate in a proximal ulna, and as I showed you, that if the plate can be put on the side where there will be two cortices can be fixed up, if the ulna is slightly below, like a Montegia type, then I can put in the plate on the side so that I can have six cortices on both sides, keeping the two holes to three. You don't need nail in a plate in this sort of a situation, because the strain coming onto this ulna is not going to be so much like what we talk about the femur or the tibia.
Yes, any other question, Neeraj, you have with?
Yeah, this is for Dr. Tanna, sir.
Yeah.
There's a question from Dr. Shashikant Ganjale, Solapur.
Bolo, bolo.
So, whenever you are having an osteoperiosteal sleevers, should it be facing towards the fracture site or it should be away from the fracture site? Does it make any difference while shingling?
Nay, I didn't get it. Sorry.
When you described about shingling.
Shingling, ha ha ha.
Yeah. So the osteoperiosteal sliver, should you be taking it towards the fracture site or away from the fracture site?
Away from the fracture site. Because you are there on the fracture site is the place where you start with. And then you go osteoperiosteal from there and goes about an inch or inch and a half above and below on both the sides, so that you have now a good soft tissue, which is vascular, which is available around the muscle, around the bone.
Okay.
Sir, I have one question.
Bolo, bolo.
If there is a both bone forearm fracture is there, one bone is completely united, other bone is there is a resorption, then in this case, you cannot use a compression.
Then I will have to use it up with the bone graft.
Yes.
If it is a big one, then I'll put in a fibula. But if it is a small one, then I'll put a cortico-cancellous iliac crest.
In the middle of the fragment.
In the middle of the fragment, and then compress it. And I will do the shingling, and the same way I'll put the graft above and below, but in between, I'll put in a cortico-cancellous graft.
The question for Dr. Gadegone, sir.
Yes, go ahead.
Between a screw nail and a square nail, what would be your preference? This is by Dr. Tapadia from Latur.
I use nowadays a screw nail. Previously, I used to do the square nail, but there was a problem of jamming also, and as well as the removing also. This nail is a screw nail, it's a cylindrical nail. Therefore, it is easy to pass, and that the screw locks in the metaphysis. Therefore, I prefer nowadays the screw intramodal.
Yeah, and there is one more question.
Yes, sir.
How to remove a bent nail or a broken nail?
Bent nail or?
Broken nail.
Broken nail, if the fracture is non-union is there, then we have to go to the fracture site and remove the nail.
That is easiest to remove.
And same person asked, how many times you have encountered a broken screw nail at the neck?
After so many cases, probably I came across with one or two cases, that's all.
So there are more questions.
Go ahead, Neeraj.
So in forearm fracture, which bone graft is used in revision cases to Dr. Tanna, sir?
In a forearm fracture, if you don't need much of a bone, I use the proximal tibia. But if it is you need a big gap which is there, then cortico-cancellous graft from the iliac crest, anterior crest.
Ma'am, if there is one more question, there are a lot of questions actually. If there is a gap at the fracture site post-operative with a stable plate and patient is asymptomatic, how long do we wait?
I have collection of the cases which have healed up after 8 months, 9 months and a year. Approximately in my book also I have written there, if there is no pain, if you've done a good three screws above, three screws below, and if the gap is there and the stability is good, fracture will slowly heal up Nowadays, I do not put a graft there. Initially, I used to advise grafting, but if the pain is not there, pain is the criteria to me. If there is no pain, just hold on.
Yeah. Okay. So you say that there are no, that using short oblique fractures, you should not be using interfragmentary screw. I fully agree with you, but what are the indications of use of the interfragmentary screw in which type of fractures?
If you can see, Dr. Chandok showed a fracture of the radius, which was a long oblique fracture. And he mentioned about it also, that in that fracture, you do a leg screw, 2 millimeter leg screw, or a maximum is about 3.5, but I would do a two millimeter leg screw and put in a plate. But it has to be a long oblique. Very rarely in a forearm mid-shaft, you get a long oblique. Long oblique, you will get only at the end in the case which she showed there.
So you also showed that you put a plate on the other side, like normally how we do. So proximal ulna fracture, lateral side or medial side plate, which one is better?
Generally, it is the lateral side, which is easier to handle. Because on the medial side, ulnar na aayega, usko kidhar janjat karega. It's on the lateral side, mainly.
So, in mid-shaft or distal radius fractures, not exactly distal radius, means shaft fractures, have you ever taken a bone graft from the proximal ulna or the olecranon?
Yes, occasionally if there is a very small butterfly which is there, and that butterfly, I know it is loose, then I go from the proximal ulna, small part here, make a small cut, take a scoop and scoop out the bone, and then you can just, there is hardly any cut is there. The cut is only up to the scoop can go. And you can put it the scoop and take it out, and there is enough bone comes out. And as I mentioned to you, if you need bone after the whatever the plate which you put in, and I collect the bone graft from the flutes. Right. That bone graft, if it is enough, then you will need only from proximal ulna. If it is not enough, that's all what you will need.
Nitin Kimatkar, I think, wants to ask a question.
There
is a question from a delegate. In a malunited fracture bone forearm, can we use the callus of that malunited forearm as in bone graft?
It's a good question. And I think I always felt that bone which is there, callus which is formed, it is malunited, it is a good bone. I don't hesitate to use that bone at all. I make it small pieces of that bone. I chop it off. Because you got to chop it off, open up the fracture there, open the fracture, realign it, and make the small pieces of that bone, and you can use that bone. Because that is a good patient, normal human bone. It's not a pathological bone.
Sir, may I ask one question?
Bolo.
When you have used a breech plate, and there is a doubtful viability of the middle fragment, do you suggest bone grafting sometime?
Why should be a viability problem? If you have done a breech plate.
There are so many small pieces are there. Sometimes it is possible that only the periosteal sleeve is there. There is no attachment to the muscles.
Yeah, if it is needed, there is no reason why you should avoid it. Right. Because in a breech plate, you cannot wait for a long time if there is a gap. What we can wait for a long time is a transverse or a short oblique fracture, which is stable. In a breech plate, otherwise the whole plate will break. So in that situation, if there is a gap which is remaining, you go down and put in a corticocancellous graft there.
Right.
Okay. And there is a question, I think, now next. Dr. Gadegone sir, he's already answered, I think, square nail and screw nail. So that is, I want to ask you. So you said that there are complications, there are difficulty in removing the square nail. So compared to that, the screw nail is much easier to remove?
Yes. Because the series ends are there, we can unturn with the screwdriver. And if it is dull, you can grip with the bone nibbler. There is no problem.
And if I can
interfere.
Yes, sir. Sorry.
If ever I have been stuck and I had to give up, it is to remove the square nail.
Okay.
At times you are so much stuck, you can't take it out unless you can really do the osteotomy, and unless it is infected, you don't want to do that.
That is a really difficult situation to remove. Yes.
If you remember, I had put up in the general club core group.
Yes. It is difficult. It is difficult.
So today, I never accept to remove a square nail which is not painful. If it is painful, the end, then I'll say I'll cut it off, but I may not be able to remove it.
So,
one question to
Dr. Doctor, Nitin Kimatkar has a question.
Yeah,
doctor. Stainless steel plates or titanium plates?
Sorry.
Whether to use a titanium plate or a stainless steel plate?
I don't think. I always use an imported plate, and most of the time it is a titanium plate.
Yeah, doctor. And also I'll say,
I have to use a titanium plate because most of the I treat a little better class of patients. तब फिर हमको MRI करना होएगा तो होएगा ना. So that's the reason it's much easier to do a titanium plate. But today, 316L, that is the one which can be done MRI, can be done with the 316LVM. LVM, not L, sorry. 316LVM. So if you are sure of that steel, then you can use that. Otherwise, I use a titanium plate most of the time.
Is it true that the titanium nail has a more resistant to infection than steel?
Yes, of course. It has been shown very well that the infection rate in titanium is much lesser than the steel. I wouldn't say it's not a very big difference, not much lesser. It is lesser in a titanium than in a steel. You have the other opinion?
No, that is how it is.
Dr. Yogesh wants to ask a question.
Sir, my question is to Dr. R.M. Chandak, sir.
Yes, go ahead.
When you are putting a bone graft, there has been concern raised in literature about the radioulnar synostosis if it's placed on the medial side towards the intraosseous membrane. So what's your say on this? Have you experienced any such situation?
No, basically, it is very rare situation where you would be putting bone graft so medially that it is going into the across the intraosseous space. You are usually putting bone graft enveloping the fracture side. So there is no, I have never found it actually after a bone grafting. Wherever I found out a synostosis, it was a surprise, not after a repair of a non-union. So it does happen. The cause is unknown. It is mostly violation of the intraosseous space, but it does happen in very few selected patients, not very commonly seen.
Because as we said, when we are doing it in a non-union, all what we are doing is shingling and we are only around that one bone. So we are not really invading the other intraosseous membrane at all.
Okay. That may be true in the whenever there is a fracture at the same site and you are dealing with the both side bone grafting. Probably it may happen like this. Otherwise, I don't think it is there.
Yeah, sir, there is a question from Dr. Sauji, sir, from Nagpur. Any combination of the nail and a plate, so what you call as a hybrid fixation.
In a forearm, I have never used it. I don't think in a femur I use it very 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 often. Or I would say in a non-union setup, I may use it almost 95% of the time.
Yeah, what he's asking is one nail, one bone nail, and the other bone plate.
Oh, is it? That is what he is asking.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Dr. Yogesh, is it what
he's
asking?
Sir. Yeah. He wants to know any role of a nail and a plate combination.
There is no harm in that, I think. There's no harm in that.
The only thing
is, once you're doing a plating and once you're doing a nailing, that means the nailing is not a very stable construct. So probably you will be obliged to give it a plaster.
Yeah.
If you're doing it a plating, do a plating on the other side so you don't need a plaster. If you're doing a nailing which is closed on both sides, which I do still today, and I do a plaster, which is an excellent surgery. But if you are opening it up on one side, now what is the problem?
Yeah.
Sir, I'll actually extend that. I have done at least 3 cases in the last 2 years. What happens is that when the radius is too proximal, I'm very afraid to open it because of the posterior intraosseous now. Mm-hmm. So Allah, I may be plating it and the radius, I just nail it.
But that is a very poor area for nailing because there is a proximal fracture of the radius. There is a big medullary cavity. So the nail will not really stabilize it as much. You will have to rely purely on the plaster. And there will be a supination pronation movement which will occur because of the pull of the muscle. So as a matter of fact, I feel this is the indication only of a plating.
Yes, sir. I do agree, sir. And it is only leaving that inhibition only once to go into that zone. Once you explore that area, It's not difficult to plate that.
Neeraj.
Yes.
You go in the center and you look for the biceps tendon.
Right.
If you get a biceps tendon, then go to biceps tendon from the other side. Don't cut there and anything you have to ask.
But you will still take the Henry's approach only.
Absolutely.
There are more questions. Last two, I think. So you showed a recon plate to treat non-union.
I have shown.
That is what I don't agree to it. Basically, I think that was a case which you inherited with a recon.
I say this is a recon plate which should not be used.
Should not be used.
I think that is a wrong question to ask.
Rather, in the take home also, he said no recon plate.
No recon plate.
Yes.
So what are the complications of the...
Can I ask a question to Dr. Sandhya?
Yes.
No, sorry, we can't hear. There is a
Nitin, you go ahead.
I want to ask one question to Dr. Tanna, sir. In the proximal ulna fracture with montage gap, I'll phone you later. Or you use the anatomical reconstruction?
Can you repeat, please? I'm sorry.
Sir, montage gap fractures.
Montage gap fracture. Yeah.
You use a normal DCPs or you use the anatomical reconstruction? Anatomical plates and recent plates to reconstruct the proximal ulna?
His question is, for a proximal ulna fracture montagia, would you like to use an anatopical ulnar plate, proximal, or a routine DCP?
If it is a very high fracture montagia, which doesn't happen, which happens, a montagia is always a slightly lower fracture, I'll use a normal DCP on the side, as I mentioned to you.
Yeah. If I rephrase that question, are you required to bend this plate gently to take care of the ulnar bow?
Possibly.
So I think the surgeon wanted that answer, possibly.
So there are two more questions from the, all these questions are coming from Ortho TV website. They are not my personal questions except for one. So there is, instead of the shingling, can you use a ENT microbur drill or have you ever used it to make it a rough surface for bone grafting?
I work in all 5-star hospitals where is it available. Microbur can also, it can also burn the bone. You don't want to use it in a non-union setup. You only want to have a good vascular structure. So don't do anything.
The aim is not to make bone khurdura. The aim is to open up the channels, vascular channels, rather than burning them.
So there is one question to Dr. Chandak on plating.
Yes.
So that is actually my question. So in a young patient, whether he's affording or not, that is not the question. So in a young patient, would you want to do a DCP or would you want to do a locking plate in a radius ulna fracture?
For my personal choice in a both bone forearm is a normal LCDCP. Not a locking plate. The reason is the locking screws are more thicker than the normal bone, the normal screws.
Why do you need a locking plate in a young man? Such lovely bones, you don't need them.
Yeah. Hey, but sir, do you get an imported non-locking plate nowadays?
Of course you get it.
You still get it. Okay.
My one question.
Yes. Yes,
in the junctional part of the radius, there is actually difficulty in restoring the radial bow. So what do you do? If the plate is a straight plate, do you contour the plate?
You have to contour the plate. Otherwise, you will not be able to do it. You will have to contour the plate. So it's what I mentioned about. You take that template and according to the template, you contour it. It is a gentle curve. You will have to give it all the way. And then you will be able to get that properly.
Yes.
Okay. I'll just check online.
There is one important question from Dr. Regunwar from Chandrapur. He wants to know, at the same level fracture, radius and ulna, having butterfly, do you still advocate nailing or a plating? This is for either Dr. Gadegone or Dr. Chandak, sir. Any amount of them.
If it is a reducible butterfly fragment, and if the nail is going through that butterfly fragment, nailing can be done. Otherwise, plating is the best answer for a large butterfly fragment. Yogesh, you take chandak?
Yeah, Yogesh, both of us would be doing nailing for that fish.
I will also be doing the nailing for that fish.
So there are last two questions from the audience on Ortho yes. TV. In the proximal radial fracture, you said plating is more indicated. What about Dr. Gadegone, who has not done plating in so many years? What about stack nailing in the proximal radial fracture?
Actually, yes. I love.
Yes, shown that, no?
Niraj, don't misunderstood me. Misunderstand me. I love to do plating, but I can achieve the same result by closed method. Why cannot be done? So I do a stack nailing. That is the. Like Abhitabh Bachchan and Jaya Bhaduri, long nail and short nail. So that is how it is. But the plating is a gold standard. There is no problem. But if you can do it by closed method, why should not you do it?
Hey, I was saying that, see, he showed for the distal radius, for the galesi, but for the proximal, I don't remember seeing it.
Proximal, I don't recommend for near the joints. It's not recommended because it's very difficult to get with the nailing. Plating is the answer.
So
don't misunderstand. Gadegone yes. does more nailing than any one of us. Gadegone yes. does more plating than any one of us. Yes. So have no illusion that Gadegone does only nailing.
Yeah. So, Neeraj wants to ask.
Yeah, there is.
Sir, this is a question for Dr. Tanna sir from Dr. Punkar Amravati. He wants to know nailing, when you lose a radial bow, the supination pronation is restricted. So how do you overcome this situation?
As I said, when I am using the imported Anders nail, the bow is very well reduced. You do not get you do not straighten it out. If you use the straight nail or if you use a square nail, then probably this could happen. But nowadays, I don't use the square nail at all. I use in the Anders nail, obviously, I think I can use any imported Anders nail, which the radial bow can be very well completely restored.
One which you're using is, I think, the tense nail.
Yeah.
Or the Is it the tense nail or the Anders nail? Tense nail, right? The titanium.
Yeah.
So that is a tense nail, I think, basically, which is olden. And I think Anders nail is different. Dr. Chanda, can you?
Sorry. What you say is true. Tense nail,
yes,
not Anders nail.
What you were understanding that sir is using a titanium elastic nail. Titanium elastic nail. Yes. But sir, titanium elastic nail, you have to create a bow.
Yeah.
You have to create a bend for them.
No, I think in a synthesis nail which is coming, which maximum you can go is 2.5. You don't have to create a bow.
Okay.
I fully agree with this, sir. Actually, 2.5 does not require. If you are going more than 2.5, then probably you need it.
Then you need it.
Gadegone, sir, many times I am a fan of closed nailing. The result of nailing have changed after closed nailing procedure. Many times I do not get an adequate bow in a both bone forearm closed nail. Still, the result is good. Why so?
Because this CN Kulkarni says that the adaptation of the forearm is such that actually when the patient gets pain, only if the inferior radial joint disc is ruptured. Otherwise, the rest of the time, the bone gets adaptation and terminal range of movement, that is extreme supination and pronation, actually we don't exactly require for many activities.
Patient doesn't realize that really yes, the yes, extremes yes. of movement, he may not get it, but yes. still it doesn't handicap him at all.
Yes.
So there is one last question from the audience. Mid shaft radius while putting the plate on the lateral surface, what do you do with the pronator teres attachment? This is, I think, we don't put the plate on the lateral surface.
No, he is right. Actually, we get the pronator teres attachment. It's a long attachment, it's an aponeurotic attachment insertion. So you may just make two or three small nicks with the blade and you can put your plate. You do not erase it completely. You can put plate on that. No problem.
Okay. I think we are done with all the questions. Dr. Yogesh, Dr. Nitin Kimatka, do you have any questions?
No. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah. And we must thank Niraj for bringing this up. This is actually a common topic of general interest and we have a keen interest in closed nailings and other procedure and commonly done procedure. And it brings out a lot of points when we hear others doing the same tricks. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Dr. Tanna sir, Dr. Gadegone sir, and Chandak sir. It has been really fantastic listening to your ideas, views, and getting many of our doubts cleared. Thank you really very much. You had a great time.
And we must all appreciate Tanna sir. He has interest and he creates in every subject whatever he touches. Thank you very much, sir.
God is kind.
Yeah, thank you.